Well, good morning, Cornerstone. Aren't you glad to be in the house of God today? You know, it's always good to be in the presence of God, and we just want to welcome everyone that's here in the auditorium. We want to welcome those that are watching online or are in the gathering place this morning, and encourage you all to check in on Facebook, let people know what's happening at Cornerstone. Some of you had the opportunity this morning to be a part of Frank's Connect group, reading through the Bible in 1 year. I heard a lot of awesome reports about that. Well, as I was doing my study this morning, I've been doing that since the beginning of the year, and they talked today about the sanctuary of the Lord and the Shekinah glory of God. Do you know what the Shekinah glory of God is? That's when you can tangibly feel the presence of God. I am believing for that in Cornerstone today, that as we gather together and we worship Him in His presence, that we are going to feel it, that it's not just something that we're reaching out in faith, but we are feeling the presence of God as we worship today. So stand up, shake somebody's hand, and tell them, I'm expecting to experience the presence of God today.
Keep singing.
Lord.
Broken day. we just stand in awe of you this morning. God, we thank you that because of your grace, because of your mercy, we can come boldly before your throne, God, just as we are, to worship you with everything we have. So that's what we choose to do here this morning. Come on, this morning, just lift your hands to Jesus. Tell him he's worthy in this place. Lord, you're worthy. God, we thank you for your presence in this place. Lord, we thank you for who you are, God. That you give us the access, God. You give us the ability, God, to just come boldly before your throne and just to spend time with the King of Kings as we are. But God, I thank you that you don't allow us to just stay as we are, God. But God, you change us. God, you transform us, God, when we worship you. You transform us when we're in your presence, when we hear your word. So right now, we just open up our hearts to receive from you and just invite you to come and have your way. Come and have your way in this place, Jesus. We give you all the praise, honor, and glory. It's in Jesus' name we pray. And everybody said, amen. Thanks so much for worshiping with us.
Man, thanks, team. The Bible teaches that one of the ways to praise God is with the hand clap. And when we do that, we're just thanking him. And so can we do that this morning? I mean, we're here this morning. I think he's worthy, right? This is the day the Lord has made, right? Come on. You're not in the hospital. Come on. Amen. You're sitting with your spouse and not fighting. Come on, that's worth something right there. Some of you are like, you're not sure on that one. It's okay. It's all good. Hey, glad you're here this morning. If you have your Bible app, open up to the book of Ephesians chapter 3. This is the third message in a series about the book of Ephesians entitled Sit, Walk, Stand. And in this, the book of Ephesians can basically be broken down into those three categories. One, realizing that we are seated with Christ, and that speaks of spiritual authority, the power of prayer, the power of his name that is available for every believer. The walking part mentions this life, that how we are to learn to live by faith in this life. Remember that we are not physical beings having a spiritual experience. We are spirit beings having a temporary physical experience here on this earth. But everything that we learn on this earth is training for eternity. We learn to build a relationship with God and walk with God so that when we go into eternity, we are used of God. And then lastly, the stand is talking about spiritual warfare. And we're going to learn how to do spiritual warfare to come against the strongholds in your life. So we've been working our way through this book, Ephesians chapter 3, and we're going to start and go through several of the verses here. Verse 1, Paul, remember Paul wrote this epistle, this letter to the church while he was in prison. And he says, for this reason, I, Paul, the prisoner of Christ Jesus, for you Gentiles. Now, first of all, let's stop for just a moment. Paul says, for this cause. What is the cause? What is Paul's cause? Well, in order to understand that, you've got to go back to chapter 2 where we spent last week, and Paul led up to all of this talking about the church. Paul's cause was the church. He's talking about this beautiful mosaic of people that come from different backgrounds, different ethnicities, different social, economic standards, and yet they're all able to come together and work together. Even though there's a lot of things that we don't have in common because we all have our own story, we all come from our own place, we all have our own life, but when we come together, we form this thing called the church. And it is an amazing thing that puts on display the love of God, the power of God, the heart of God. And it doesn't just stay behind the walls of the church. It goes out into the community, into the marketplace. And Paul says, this is my cause. This is what I'm all about. And I just have to say that I'm with Paul on that. This is my cause. This is my passion, is the church. I've often said that when it comes to the local church, I'm a huge fan. I believe in the church. No one does what we do. See, if you're in the business world has a bottom line. That bottom line is called profit. Are we making a profit? Now, there is a business aspect to the church, and that's part of it. But our bottom line is not profit. Our bottom line is eternity. We are dealing with eternity. We are dealing with changed lives. We are affecting people for the rest of their lives and helping them to be better in whatever it is that God has called them to do. So we have the same cause that Paul had, and that was to reach people. Look at verse 2 then. He goes on to say in verse 2, he said, "Indeed, if indeed you have heard of this dispensation of grace of God, which was given to me to give to you." Paul talks about the dispensation of grace. Now, there are 7 dispensations in the Bible. I'm only going to mention the last 3 because that's what really affects us. The last 3 dispensations was, first of all, the dispensation of the law. This began with Moses when Moses gave the 10 commandments to Israel. That was the law. This is what they lived under. These were the guidelines. This is what guided their life. But we couldn't live under the law because we always fell short. But the dispensation of the law lasted until Christ died on the cross, and that killed the law. Then we came into the dispensation of grace, or the dispensation of the church, that started on the day of Pentecost, 50 days after Jesus' death. Then the dispensation of grace started when the Holy Spirit was poured out. That's where we live. This is our dispensation. We live in the dispensation of grace, the church age. The third dispensation is the millennial reign of Christ, and that is after the rapture, when Jesus comes back after the rapture, Jesus comes back, and then for 1,000 years, he rules and reigns on this earth. So there's God's prophetic calendar so that we know where our place is on this calendar. So there are 3 dispensations, and we currently are in the dispensation of grace. Let me define dispensation. Dispensation is how God deals with people, mankind, at certain times or length of times. How God deals with mankind at a certain time for a certain length of time. And so this is the dispensation of grace. What is grace? Grace is God giving me what I need, not what I deserve. Now, I want to be real careful and not just read over that. Grace is God giving me what I need and not what I deserved. I deserve to die. I deserve to reap the harvest of sin. I deserve to live a life in bondage, but that's not what I needed. What I needed was a second chance. What I needed was unconditional love. What I needed was God to look at me and value me and give me a hand up so that I could start over. And that's what he did. That's why we are living in the dispensation of grace. Another definition of grace, G-R-A-C-E, is God's riches at Christ's expense. It's free to us, but it cost Jesus everything he had. He laid down his life so that we could live in this dispensation of grace. So we are in the church age. Think about this for just a moment. Kind of give you an idea of what is the church. The church was never meant to be a place of organized religion, but to be a place where we cultivate a relationship with God. The church is not about a bunch of do's and don'ts and rules and regulations. The church is about us being here and learning how to develop a relationship with God. So when we come together every week, it's not a business meeting, but it's all about building relationship with each other and primarily with God. So we have that understanding of where we're going with this. Let me give you an illustration. See, the church doesn't exist and was never intended to exist to tell you how bad you are. The church was designed to show you how good God is. And that's what brings us to a place of change when we realize that God is a good God. And so the church is called to be a dispenser of grace. We push grace on, we're grace peddlers, right? We're grace pushers. We push grace onto the lives of others. Let me give an illustration of why oftentimes we struggle with grace. On September 22nd, 1869, that's the date of the signing of the Emancipation Proclamation when slavery was ended in America. And so 2 things happened when that was signed. The first thing that happened was that slaves that were in bondage were set free, but what happened is that many of them never changed their lifestyle. They had lived generation after generation under bondage as a slave that they didn't know how to live free. So when freedom came, many of them stayed doing what they were doing. Even though they were no longer under the law of that, they didn't know how to live free. How many of you realize there's a lot of Christians that don't know how to live free? You've been purchased out from under the load of sin, the bondage of sin. But we still don't know how to live free. We go right back into guilt and condemnation. We go right back into works because that's all we've ever known. The second thing that happened after the signing of the Emancipation Proclamation, many people did experience freedom, but a majority did not. And what a lot of people did is that even after that was signed, some 2.5 years later, there were still people living as slaves because they never got the word. It took time for it to travel, and many people opposed it, but it took time for that to travel into certain states to let those people know you are free. And so there are still people today that they are free, but we got to go tell them. They haven't got the good news yet. They haven't heard the good news that Jesus died for your sin. You don't have to live under that burden of sin. You don't have to live under guilt and condemnation. They are free. They just don't know it yet. And it's our responsibility as a church to follow our mission statement, which is to take Jesus to others. So we're living under the dispensation of grace. Now look at verse 3 and what he says here. He says, how that by revelation he made known to me the mystery, as I have written, which you read, that you may understand my knowledge, the mystery of Christ. Let me focus in on this word mystery for just a moment. He said he made made known by revelation the mystery. What is the mystery? First of all, the Bible is not a mysterious book, and God is not a mysterious God. I know we've heard all of our life that he works in mysterious ways, but he doesn't. The Bible is not a mystery book. There are no mysteries in the Bible. The Bible is a book that explains itself and reveals itself. Now, the people in the Old Testament, it was a mystery. The church age was a mystery. They didn't understand the church age. And that's what Paul is talking about. Here's the mystery. It's revealed to us, but the saints and the prophets in the Old Testament couldn't get their mind around it. They couldn't comprehend what is this thing called grace. In fact, you remember Judas, who sold out Christ. See, he thought that when Jesus showed up on planet Earth, that Jesus was going to raise up an army, a physical army, and he was going to conquer Rome. The Jews hated the Romans. And so when Judas found out that Jesus was not going to bring up an army and physically level Rome and topple Rome, he became discouraged and disheartened, and he sold out everything. He basically skipped the church age. What Jesus was saying is the Old Testament didn't understand. There was a mystery here. It's the mystery of grace. But now we understand it. We are grace people in that sense. Paul is talking about the church, and that this is that dispensation. So what does the dispensation of the church look like? We need to know this because this is our timeline on God's calendar. Here's a quick checklist, a thumbnail of what the dispensation of grace or the church dispensation looks like. You might want to write these down. First of all, sin is forgiven and not pushed forward. That's good news, right? See, what happened before is when they dealt with sin, they just simply kicked the can down the road and put it off. They just made it someone else's problem because sin couldn't be forgiven. It could only be postponed. But when Christ came, he didn't come to just push your sins forward. He came to get rid of them. So my sin is not just covered. My sin is forgiven. It's gone because of Jesus. That's good news. The second thing is this, is that grace is greater than sin. All right? And so no matter, even if I sin as a believer, God's grace still covers me. If I'm willing to repent of it and bring it to God, God's grace covers me and I am forgiven. Number 3 is the individual priesthood of every believer, meaning that we no longer have to go through a man or to a man to get to God. We've got a direct hotline to heaven, and so at any time, at any point, we can call out to God, cry out to God. He hears our prayers, and he answers our prayers because we have this divine priesthood with him. Next is the infilling of the Holy Spirit. This is a dispensation of the Holy Spirit. We have the authority of the believer, spiritual authority. We have the gifts of the Holy Spirit. And then we have the church. Now, let me take and break this down because, as I said, I'm like Paul. This is my passion. And if you haven't seen this, let me show you a little bit of my spiritual DNA. This is my vision for the church. This is why I love the church. I'm going to take the word church here, and we're going to break it down, and we'll remember it this way. As I show you what each part of the church is, the first thing about the church in my vision of the church is that it is Christ-centered. In other words, everything that we do has to be focused on Christ. We have to ask ourselves, does it pass the litmus test? Is this something that we want to do, or is this something that at the end of the day is going to lift up Jesus and people are going to see him? Because at the end of the day, that's who we're accountable to. We only want to do things that draw glory to Christ and not glory to us. So everything that we do is focused around the central theme. Does it lift up Jesus? Does it promote Jesus? The second thing about church is that it is Holy Spirit led. We are in the dispensation of the Holy Spirit, meaning that he leads us and he guides us. That means almost every service we have, before we go into that service, we stop and ask, God, will you just show up? Maybe you want to do a God moment. We have a plan. We've practiced. We've rehearsed. We've written, you know, we've written songs. We've written messages. We've prepared. We've made announcements. But God, somewhere in that service, you may want to interrupt. You may want to do something that's not on the outline, and we're okay with that. Not only that, but there are times that we may be doing things that we have to stop and ask, Holy Spirit, do you want this? Or there are times that the Holy Spirit just shows up and says, here's what I want to do. And we always have our spiritual sensors out saying, Holy Spirit, is this something that you're going to be involved in our lives? I also think that when we come to church, that church should be what I call uncommon. There's nothing common about church. I don't think that when you come to the church, you ought to have the same experience that you have in the world. I think the church ought to look different than the PTA meeting. I think church ought to look different than just a group meeting. I think church ought to have some supernatural power of God. In fact, I think one of the things about the church is that it should be natural to see the supernatural. So I think church should be uncommon, where lives are changed and people are impacted by whatever God is doing. And then next to the letter R, I'm going to put the word reaching. And this is something we're always doing. Think of it this way. The church is always reaching, first of all, up. Because as I said, if we have to experience God, that's first and foremost. When people come through the doors of this church, they have to have more of an encounter with God than they do with men, because men cannot change lives. Only God can change a life. So our goal is to get people looking upward and encountering God. We're always reaching up. But not only are we reaching up, we're praying that God is reaching in. We pray that when we have a service that God is speaking to you. See, church is where I recalibrate my life. Church is where God speaks to me. Church is where God looks at me from the inside out and says, I want you to change here. And the Holy Spirit is the life changer there, right? So not only are we reaching up and reaching in, but of course we're reaching out, because church isn't just about me. It's always looking to reach others. It's always bringing others into the fold. It's always thinking about those that aren't here, the unchurched, or those that need to be rechurched. Next is the letter C, which I call changed lives. And this is why I never get tired of doing what we do. I never get tired of seeing people's lives changed. Sometimes we see dramatic changes. Sometimes we see just great victories. Sometimes we see people go from darkness to light. Sometimes we see big changes. You know what? I'm okay with the little changes. I'm okay with attitude changes. I'm okay with things being forgiven. I'm okay with people coming to here and getting better. And I think that's great as well. And then lastly, when I think of church, I think of church as home. This is a community. God places us where he wants us to be. And so we have this place called home, where God wants us to be established there. In fact, go back to verse 7 here. He says in verse 7 of this chapter, of which I, talking about the church, of which I became a minister according to the gift of grace given to me by the effective working of his power. Now here's what Paul says. Paul says, of all the people in the church, I'm the least. When really he had the biggest title, here was Paul. He was an apostle. It's a pretty big title. He wrote 2/3 of the New Testament. People always look to him for leadership, but Paul said, when it comes to church, I'm the little guy. I'm the one that doesn't matter. He was saying, it's not about me, but it's about God. So he wanted everybody to keep their eyes on God and what he was doing. Paul humbled himself. If you ever want to be promoted, humble yourself. Remember when they were looking for a king in the Old Testament? And so they brought all of David's brothers in, all of Jesse's sons, and they lined them up. They didn't even bother to bring David in. He was so unworthy. He was just an asterisk, you know, in the whole family there. He was just a side thought, an afterthought. And so the prophet went through every brother, said, not you, not you, not you. He said, surely there's got to be someone else. And his father said, well, there's one more kid, but he's not much to look at. He said, bring him to me. They brought him to him. He said, that's the king. The point that I'm making is that David humbled himself. David was happy being a shepherd. David was happy doing what he was doing. He wasn't passing out business cards. He wasn't building a resume. He wasn't going around shaking hands. He was just saying, you know, Lord, I'm going to do what I do. I'm going to praise you and serve you and work for you. The key to promotion is humbling yourself. Well, the job that I'm on, nobody knows I'm there. God knows. Nobody knows how hard I'm working. God knows. My boss never sees the amazing things that I see. God knows. And if your boss doesn't promote you, God will. See, the same way in church, you don't need to. See, let me say it this way. Man rises up, God raises up. The key to being promoted is just getting lower in the presence of God and say, God, I'm just here to serve. I just want to be something that you can use. In fact, 1 Peter 5, 6 backs that up. 1 Peter 5, 6 says, humble yourself, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, that who may exalt you? That he may exalt you. Years ago, I used to teach what we call the Welcome to the Family class. It's now called the Next class, and we've got great leadership in the church that's teaching that. But one of the things I would always do in that class, because I wanted people to understand my role of a pastor. Because many times people have the wrong idea of a pastor. Many times pastors have the wrong idea of a pastor. And so, I've never been comfortable. Let me just go ahead and show you. My idea of a pastor is not up here with an entourage. It's not up here with people following me. I'm not comfortable with all of that. I'm not comfortable with people carrying my stuff. I'm not comfortable with people following me around. I'm not comfortable with that. And I'm not saying because someone else is, it's wrong. I'm just saying it's not me. And when God said, here's what a pastor is, how do I tell people what it means to be a pastor? Because it's not just being up here saying, I'm the leader, I'm in charge. Being a pastor is the opposite. When I say I'm the pastor, I say it from this position. That says, I'm here to serve. That's all. Church is not about me, it's about you. How do we make your life better? How do we help you get to where you're going? And when I began to pastor people, I had to realize, God, you've got to help me because I don't have what it takes to lead people. I need your anointing, I need your wisdom, I need your help. There are problems I don't know how to solve, and if you're not helping me, this is going to be a horrible experience for me and for them. And so pastoring comes from this position where I say, God, you show me how to be a better servant. And so that's what Paul was doing. Paul said, I just humble myself. I may have a lot of responsibility, but he says, it's not about me. It's about God, and it's about what God is doing, what God wants to do in our lives. Go to verse 13 as we work our way through this chapter here. And he says in verse 13, therefore, I ask that you do not lose heart at my tribulations for you, which is your glory. Remember, Paul is in prison when he writes this letter. So he's telling those around him, basically, listen, don't feel sorry for me. What I'm going through is for your benefit. I'm going through it, but I have the forethought to know that as I'm going through this, it's going to bless you. So Paul is saying, don't feel sorry for me. Don't let my circumstances discourage you. Don't blame God because I'm in prison. Paul is saying, God's going to use my experience to be a blessing to someone else. Now, let me just say this, just as a pastoral word of advice. If you ever know someone that's going through a difficult time in their life, and maybe they're grieving or maybe something terrible has happened in their life, please don't go to that person and say, God's going to use you to help someone else go through this. It may be true, but that's not the time to say it. That's not the time for healing right then. Just let them get through their grief. So just a friendly word of advice. When somebody is going through a tragedy in their life, don't say God's going to use you to help somebody else. He may, he will, but just help that person be healed right then. But how many know that what we go through, we ought to let God shape us to take others through it. We ought to let God use us to walk through that situation in their lives. So this is what Paul is saying. I'm going through this, but it's going to be for your benefit. So that's good advice. Don't spend too much time looking at your circumstance. Don't spend too much time focusing what's wrong on your life because you're going to miss what's right with your life. So Paul was saying, don't look at me. Don't be upset where I'm at. God's going to use you, and God's going to do a work in your life. Now, the last part of that verse, he says in there, faint not at my tribulation for you, which is your glory. He said, you're going to benefit from my hardship. How many realize that every generation has benefited from the past generation? See, we stand here today as a church, and we are better because of those that built the church before us. We may look back at that church and say, man, they did some weird things in church. But we never need to do it with a weird attitude or an arrogant attitude saying, thank God we're better than them. Because if it weren't for them, we couldn't be where we are. We stand on the shoulders of every generation. We stand on the shoulder of how they used to do church and how we're doing church today. And guess what? There's going to be a group of people 20 years that look back at our church and say, what a bunch of morons. They didn't know what worship was. They didn't know the good songs. They didn't know what worship was all about. So we never look down at where a church is at and what we're doing, because a few years from now, we're going to be irrelevant the way we're doing things. It just changes. That's why, see, people say, well, why do we have all the lights? I don't know. People like it. Can I just tell you this? A light won't change your life. If lights change lives, how many of you know that Las Vegas would be the salvation capital of the world, but it's not? Lights aren't going to change your life, but I like them. You know why? Because there's a generation out there that thinks it's cool, so whatever it takes, let's bring them in, right? But we can't say that, because somewhere down the road, they're going to look at our church and say, no, this is how you do it now. And I'm like, praise God. See, I never want our church to become a one-generation church. I want us always to be looking to the next generation. You've heard me say this. I don't care about the lights. I don't like or dislike them. Music, I got my own style of music. Some songs I like, some songs I don't, but it's not about me. I'm thinking about your kids and your grandkids. I'm thinking about the next generation. I'm thinking about the unchurched. I want them in church. I don't want to grow a white-haired old church. Sorry, Danny. Well, you knew not to sit on the front row. I always use examples. You had it. How'd you get such a young wife? You don't know either, huh? Amen. I'll preach to this side. I feel safe over here. If he gets up out of his chair, let me know. That's all I ask. If he makes a move this direction, tell me. I want us to be a church that's young. I want us to be a church that's always inviting new people in. I want us to be a church that's just reaching out to that next generation, because it's our responsibility to pass the torch to the next generation. If we just take it from our generation and say, bless God, we found it and we'll die with it, what a horrible failure. And let me just say this. I thank God for the white-haired people in our church. I thank God that you are here. I thank God that you are working. I thank God that you are serving. I thank God that you have the same vision. Let's reach some young people. Let's do some things differently. Let's reach out to that next generation. It blesses me when I see people Carol's age and older that are just reaching out and love. Okay, keep an eye on her too. All right, we got two of them. I'm sensing bad vibes from the front row here. Hey, you know what I'm talking about, though, right? It's all about that next generation coming in. We've got to love them. We've got to reach them. That's why we invest in them, because our responsibility. I want to be like David. You know what they said about David when he died? He reached his generation. He served his generation well. Praise God. That's a great testimony to have, that he served his generation well. Now, I want to stop right here, because this is what I call a God moment. When I was writing, and each time I'm preparing a sermon and writing some things together, I always stop and say, God, if there's something you want to say, just change course. And it's right here as I was writing, God said, I want you to stop, and I want you to just talk to the people about this. That there's some people here today that need to hear this. And this is what I call a God moment in your life. I just want you to know this. Whoever this is for, God will never let you down. Man will let you down, man will fail you, man will disappoint you, but God will never fail you. And the disappointment that you're having right now is not God-sent or God-centered. God is your answer, not your problem. So I just want you to know, because sometimes a lot of people have the attitude thinking that God doesn't care. And maybe some of you are facing that right now, because your life is so messed up, it's so tangled up, and it's so frustrating, and you think God doesn't even care. Maybe you have the idea that says, it's not going to happen. I've believed and I've waited, but I just don't think it's going to happen. And here's what I'm saying to you this morning. Stop it. Quit thinking that way. That is not helpful. That is not healthy. That is not God-like. That is not something that God is doing. Quit thinking that way. This is a spiritual wake-up call from God. Quit thinking those thoughts. Joyce Meyer made this statement. She said, we are not filled with the Holy Spirit to do easy things. We are filled with the Holy Spirit to do impossible things. So even though it's difficult right now, it's not impossible, and God will get you through that. Never forget this. The bigger the obstacle, the bigger your future. Come on, if Joel Osteen would have said that, you would have been applauding right now. Come on now. The bigger, thank you. I told you I have no pride. Come on. The bigger the obstacle, the bigger your future. Go to verse 16. He says in verse 16 that he, God, would grant you according to his riches of his glory to be strengthened with might through his spirit in the inner man. To be strengthened with his might by his spirit in the inner man. Taylor's translation says it this way, the mighty inner strengthening of his Holy Spirit. How many of you realize this morning you have an inner man? You know what I'm talking about? Every one of us here, when you look in the mirror, what you see is not what you get. There's more to the man in the mirror than you can see in the reflection. There is a spirit being on the inside of you. There is a spiritual part of you that is there, that is a God part, that is more God-like. And God says, I never want you to forget the spirit side of life. And then he says, because you have an inner man, he says, always remember this, that your inner man needs to be strengthened. So we're on a continual journey of praying and seeking and growing spiritually so that we can be strengthened from the inside out. We have to be spirit-minded or to be more aware of spiritual things in our life. In fact, the word strengthened here in the Greek is the word kratos, and it means ruling power. And we touched on this last week, that our spirit is to rule over our flesh and over our mind. The spirit is in charge of your thoughts, changing the way you think, and the spirit is in charge of your body, controlling the flesh. See, when you got born again, God put his spirit into your spirit, and you were changed from the inside out. That's God doing his part. Your part and your responsibility now is to renew your mind and control your flesh and let the spirit man inside of you rule and reign over your life. Look at verse 17. He then says in verse 17, that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you being rooted and grounded in love. Let's break that down for just a moment. He said that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you being rooted and grounded in love. Now, let me take the first part of that. That Christ may dwell in your heart. It literally says that Christ may be at home in your hearts by faith, that you being rooted and grounded in love. Think about that for just a moment. Christ being at home in your heart. Christ being at home in your life. Let me ask you this question. Is Jesus at home in your life, or is he always a guest? Now, there's a huge difference between being at home and being a guest. Because when you are a guest at someone's house, it's always a little awkward. When you're a guest at someone's home, it's always a little uncomfortable. Because there are certain rooms that are off limit. You just can't go make yourself at home. There are certain things that you don't do because you're trying to be a good guest, and so you don't have the freedom that you do when you're at your own home. And there are a lot of people that Jesus is a guest in their life and not at home, meaning there are certain places that are off limits. There are certain places that he's not made to feel totally welcomed or wanted. But when you come to the place that you make Jesus at home in your life, it basically says every area of my life is open. Jesus, come into my life, look at my life. I want you to be comfortable with me. I don't want to always have this uncomfortable eggshell relationship. I want to be at home with Jesus in my life. So there's a difference there. He's made to feel welcome because it's his home too. Then he says in this verse that we need to be rooted and grounded in love. Rooted means this. Roots determine how high you can grow. You'll never grow spiritually. You'll never grow up spiritually until you become anchored in the things of God. You'll never go deeper in the things of God. You'll never be a mature Christian until you put down some spiritual roots or have a spiritual root system. So what does a spiritual root system of a Christian look like? Very quickly, let me just read them off to you. The spiritual root system of a Christian is commitment. Don't be a fan of Jesus, be a follower of Jesus. Fans are the ones that stand, that remain in the stands and cheer you on. But if you're having a bad season, they'll boo you. You want to be a teammate down on the field working with Jesus. Maturity is a root system. When we do what Paul says, when he says to put away childish things, discipleship is part of your roots. Following Jesus, that's when WWJD, what would Jesus do, becomes a lifestyle and not just a catchphrase. Relationships. How many know that people around us keep us rooted? If you've ever seen like these giant sequoias, the thing about them is they're not rooted that deeply. For as big as these trees grow, hundreds of feet up in the air, their root systems goes less than 12 foot deep. But what happens is they reach out into the root systems of other trees, and so they're linked together. So when the winds come and the storms come, not only do they have their roots, but they have the roots of the trees around them that are tying them and anchoring them together. That's that whole thing called community. That's that whole thing called relationships, that iron sharpens iron and keeps us going in the right direction. Giving, because where our heart is, that's where our treasure is also. And so it says we're to be rooted and grounded in love. Love is always my motivation. Love is why I do what I do. Why do I serve? Because my name's on a calendar. And my ministry leader will get upset if I don't show up. No. I serve because of love. I love God. I love the church. I love people. I love helping people get to Christ. Why do I give? Because of love. Where a man's treasure is, that's where his heart will be also. Why do I take Jesus to others? Because I know what a difference he made in my life. That's why I'm always focused on thinking about others. Do they know Christ? Why do I go the second mile? Because of love. Remember 1 Corinthians 13, the great love chapter of the Bible? And it goes to this long explanation of love is patient, kind, gentle, meek, all of these different things. Love never fails, bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things. And then God wrote at the end of that verse, the end of that chapter, now there abides faith, hope, and love. Faith, hope, and love. But the greatest is love. See, God puts more emphasis on the love aspect than he does the other part of it. This great thing that we have, love. Look at verses 18 and 19, and we'll close with this. He says in verse 18, that we may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the width and length and depth and height, to know the love of Christ which passes knowledge, that you may be filled with the fullness of God. Now there's a lot of some great verses in here, but we don't have time to get to them. But notice what he says here. He talks about four different measurements. We're talking about roots and being grounded. And here's what he says again in verse 18. What is the width, length, depth, and height of that? What is the width, length, depth, and height of that? To comprehend, he's wanting us to understand who he is. The word breadth there means storage space in the Greek. And what he's talking about, signs of a mature Christian, is this, is the breadth of God's word is to know the whole of God's word. In other words, it just says, well, I become God, I'm gonna know the word that I need for today. I'm going to know the word of God so that I'm able to do what 1 Peter 3 says, always prepared to give an answer to anyone who asks why I believe what I believe. I want to be able to not only say I have a belief system, but I want to be able to say, here's why I believe there's a God. Here's why I believe God's word, the Bible, is an inspired word of God. Here's why I believe in grace. I want to be able to share that with the lives of other people. He talks about the length. That's, remember where you are on God's timeline. That's a reference to orientation. Here's what that says. When I look at the length of God's love, I need to remember where I am. And what I do now is I filter everything through the filter of grace. Even when I read the Old Testament scriptures, I filter that through my dispensation, my timeline of grace. I don't live under the law. They did certain things back in the law that we look at today and we think, dear God, how could they do that? And there's a great book to help you, Lee Strobel, The Case for Christianity. That if you read that book, it will help you answer a lot of Old Testament questions in your life and philosophy and thoughts about God. But today, we filter everything through the dispensation of grace. Whatever happened, we have to look at it in grace. And then the height and the depth is this, is the vertical and the horizontal. I've got to have a relationship with God, and I've got to have a relationship with man. Verse 20, and I didn't bring an illustration for this, but talks about him that is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that is at work in us. And I just want to say this as we close this morning. Will you stand with me as we get ready to pray? Is that I don't think any of us really have an idea or are able to comprehend everything that God has put in us. You have unlimited potential in Jesus' name. You have unlimited resources through prayer and through faith. That when you are at the end of your resources and you are at the end of your strength, it's not over. Just begin to inventory everything that God has available to you. And if you feel like you've tied a knot at the end of your rope and you're hanging on, why don't you just let go and let God? When you've reached the end of your strength, just say, God, your grace is abundant, your power is immeasurable, and you're working in me, and through faith in you, I can get through this. Father, this morning, I thank you for your word. And I pray that in these next few moments, Father, that we just let you do a work in our lives to accomplish something in our hearts. In Jesus' name. I want you to bow your heads and close your eyes for just a moment and think about this. See, this is our opportunity to just kind of say, God, what are you speaking to me? And I think this is a very important question that I want to ask you, is that how many of us here this morning could have the prayer, and this is life-changing, that just simply says, today, you know what, Lord, today, I no longer want you to be a guest in my life. I want you to be at home in my life. I want that deeper relationship. I don't want you as my co-pilot. I don't want backseat Jesus. I want you in the driver's seat. And I want you to be at home in my life. If that's you, would you raise your hand this morning just as a sign to God that says, God, that's where I want to go. That's my goal in life. Amen. Thank you for doing that. God knows that. God sees that. But how many this morning would say this, Father, I pray. Just pray that I will love the church and take my place in the church. Anybody this morning that God is speaking to you about that, pray that I'm going to love the church like Paul loved the church. Let me see your hand this morning. And I want to take my place in the church. How many would say this morning that Pastor, pray that I won't faint in my mind. See, I feel overwhelmed and I feel like I'm struggling in some areas and I just feel like there's more problems than there are answers right now. And I don't want to faint. I just pray that God would strengthen my mind so that I don't faint in my circumstance. Anybody this morning, let me see your hand. Come on, amen. Let me pray this prayer accordingly. Father, I pray for those that are overwhelmed today. I pray for those, the Father, that are under such a burden that maybe they've not even shared it with anyone, or maybe they've shared it with very few in their circle. And I just pray, Father, this morning that overwhelming presence of their problem or of their circumstance would just begin to be put in a God perspective. God, that they would be able to take that and give it to you and say, God, I trust you. I'm going to let you move and work through my life. I'm going to let you move and minister through me. Father, I pray for those today that as they leave here today, they will spiritually be able to leave behind the pressure of that problem, knowing that it's in God's hands. It hasn't just been discarded. It hasn't been swept under the rug, but it's been left in the hands of a caring God who is working behind the scenes to solve our problems And so, Jesus, be Lord over my circumstance, be Lord over my mind. God, that I just keep moving forward with what you're doing in my life. Father, I pray for those today that said, I want Jesus to be at home in my life. I want Jesus to be at home in my life. God, that you would take their relationship with you to another level. That there would be more intimacy, there would be more openness, there would be more desire just to interact with you, God. That you would get off of a schedule and just come to a place that says, God, come into my life and I draw close to you. Father, that's my prayer today. Father, I pray for others today, just the power of prayer over their lives to bless their home, to bless their families, to bless their finances in the name of Jesus, as we pray all the time for our families of this church, that you would bless their marriages, bless their home, bless their finances, bring healing to their bodies. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. God bless you this morning.
Amen. You guys can be seated. You know, one of the things that Ron talked about was the importance of relationships. And we're constantly trying to create opportunities at Cornerstone for you to build relationships. We have our Connect groups that are going on right now. You can pick up a flyer at the Connection Center if you have not got involved in that. This Tuesday night, Bling will start a new semester study by Lisa Turkhurst, Uninvited. And it's a very, very good study about, it's a lot of it is about loneliness and feeling wanted when and loved when sometimes you don't. We have Man Up that meets on Friday mornings for coffee and men sharpening other men. And we have planned a ladies' retreat the end of March, the 31st of March through the 1st of April. Anybody in here fans of HGTV show Fixer Upper? Well, we're going down to Waco, Texas, and we're going to have the opportunity to go to Magnolia Market and just hang out down there and do some shopping. We'll have session together. We'll do a little holy yoga together. And the cost of that trip is $75. That covers your transportation, your hotel, a couple of your meals. You'll also have the expense of some other meals and whatever shopping you want to do. But we'll leave that Friday morning at 9:30 and get back late Friday night. And so we invite you to sign up to be a part of that. You can do that online. You also will need to pay a $40 deposit by the 7th of March because they're space limited. And so we need people to be making a commitment if you're wanting us to hold a space for you. So be sure and take advantage of that. But if you look in the Old Testament, in Exodus 36, verse 3, it's talking about giving, and we're going to receive our tithes and offerings in just a moment. As the ushers are getting ready, I just want to read this to you. What was going on is God had given them some very specific instructions of how the tabernacle was to be built. And it had very, very fine items that were needed, gold and bronze and expensive linens and skins and different things. And this is what they said happened. It says, they received from Moses all the offerings the Israelites had brought to carry out the work of constructing the sanctuary. And the people continued to bring freewill offerings morning after morning. So all the skilled workers who were doing all the work on the sanctuary left what they were doing and said to Moses, the people are bringing more than enough for doing the work of the Lord commanded to be done. Then Moses gave an order, and they sent his word throughout the camp. No man or woman is to make anything else as an offering for the sanctuary. And so the people were restrained from bringing more because they already had, what they already had was more than enough to do all the work. We experienced that Wednesday night at Cornerstone. We had our first That's What I'm Known For auction. We had so many people bring in so many amazing items. In fact, we ended up with more items at that auction. It was for kids. It cost almost $400 for kids to go to camp. And so this was to help pay the kids' way to camp. And we had more items brought than we had buyers. So next year, be there. But we raised almost $9,000 last Wednesday night. That is amazing. And so when I was reading this verse, I thought, that's pretty much what we had going on Wednesday night. It's like, guys, we've cut enough. We can't stay up here auctioning until midnight. But it was amazing. And we just want to thank you guys for the way you gave. And that's how Cornerstone is. You guys are so generous, and we appreciate you so much. So as we're receiving our tithes and offerings today, let's pray. Heavenly Father, as we give today, God, we thank you that you are a God of more than enough. And Father, you take what we sow and what we give, Father, and you multiply it into lives being changed by your word. God, we thank you for these kids that will be going to camp this summer and their lives will be changed. Father, I thank you for every individual that walks through these doors. And Father, the people that we touch because of your word and because of your faithfulness. And so, Father, as we give today, we just invite you to bless it and multiply it back in our community and in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Alethea. If you're our guest today, we'd love to get to know you. Please take a moment to text the word hello to 405-266-2242. You can also fill out the information card in your bulletin, drop it off at our Connection Center, and one of our volunteers will give you a special gift just for being our guest. For everyone else, don't forget to check in on Facebook and tell all your friends about what God is doing at your church. There's always something happening around here, so give us just a minute to fill you in.
Are you a new believer or are you needing to get baptized? Your next opportunity for water baptism is on Sunday, March 5th during our second service. You can sign up online or at the Connection Center. We are so proud of what God has done in your life.
Are you ladies ready for a great semester of bling? This Tuesday, we'll begin our six-week video Bible study, Uninvited, Living Loved When You Feel Less Than, Left Out, and Lonely by Lisa Turker. Childcare is provided at no cost for fifth grade and under, but you must RSVP online at cornerstone.tv 48 hours in advance.
Thanks for joining us today. If you need prayer, or if you just need someone to talk to, please visit our Life Room after service. For more information about anything here at Cornerstone, visit us online at the Connection Center or on social media.
All right, guys, we love you. Thanks so much for visiting and joining us today. You guys are dismissed. You are